everybody, signing on. Hi, everybody in here.
Good morning, everybody.
Good to see you. How are you, Vicky? You good, Vicky?
You good?
I did.
Good. Glad to hear that. Ward is going to be playing a piece by Couperin for a prelude, and I would love to invite Ward to say a little bit about what he's getting ready to play in just a moment. We're going to give people an opportunity to sign on, and in just a moment we'll get going. Welcome to St. George's, everyone.
Thus says the High and Lofty One, who inhabits eternity, whose name is Holy. I dwell in the high and holy place with him that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. Let us now stand and sing our processional hymn, hymn number 408, Sing Praise to God, verses 1 and 3.
Cares for you, always cares for you. A reading from Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him and strip kings of their robes, to open doors before him, and the gates shall not be closed. I will go before you and level the mountains. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and riches hidden in secret places, so that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen, I call you by your name. I surname you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I arm you, and though you do not know me, so that you may know me from the rising of the sun and from the west, and there is no other besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 96 will read responsibly the half verse. Sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord, all the whole earth.
Sing to the Lord and bless his name.
Proclaim the good news of salvation from day to day.
Declare his glory among the nations.
And his wonders among all peoples.
For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised.
He is more to be feared than all gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols.
But it is the Lord who makes heavens.
Oh, the majesty and magnificence of his presence.
Oh, the power and splendor of his sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples.
Ascribe to the Lord honor and power.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name.
Bring offerings and come unto his courts.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
Let the Lord earth tremble before him.
Tell it out among the nations, the Lord is King.
He has made the world so firm that it cannot be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity.
Let the heavens rejoice and let the earth be glad. Let the sea thunder and all that is in it.
Let the field be joyful and all that is therein.
Then shall all the trees of the wood shout for joy before the Lord when he comes.
When he comes to judge the earth,
he will judge the world with righteousness
and the peoples with his truth.
A reading from 1 Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Holy, and Jesus, and Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor, of love and steadfastness, of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved of God, that he has chosen you because our message of the gospel came to you, not in word only, but also in power, in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of person we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord was sounded forth from you not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known. so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols, to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our sequence hymn is We Give Thee But Thine Own, verses 1 through 5. Very short verse. Let us stand. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
this render unto Caesar what belongs to Caesar and unto God what belongs to God passage here in Matthew is a classic bit of scripture that always appears in our lectionary in the fall. Conveniently for the preachers around stewardship time. It talks about giving back to God a little of that which belongs to him already. An unfortunate happenstance, however, is the linking of something as dreaded and unpleasant as compulsory government taxation with something that is voluntary and that has to do with generosity and blessing. Both of these have to do with money, but that's where the similarities end. Because see, on the one hand, taxation is onerous to the budget, especially to middle-class budgets, and legally compulsory, with really bad consequences if you don't comply. While giving to the church is intended to be rewarding, voluntary, uplifting, freeing to the soul, and multiplying of abundance. Taxation carries with it resentment, anxiety, deadline, loss, and pain. Giving out of one's abundance to the ministries of the church bring abundance and vitality to the work of the church. And to the joy, and joy to the heart of the one who gives. When this spiritual principle of giving degenerates into something like a works-based system of rewards and punishments, rather than a person's grace-based and uplifting, grateful recognition of all that is given comes from God's abundance, we miss the point of giving. So I say shame on these Pharisees for inviting the power of the oppressive Roman government into the temple where economic justice and compassion and healing for all are to be the defining marks of God's people. These Pharisees had a consistent strategy of bringing the power of the Roman dictatorship to bear against Jesus in order to get rid of him, because it was their own power that they were intent on holding on to, and Jesus' calls for justice in their time threatened them. I've always admired the genius of Jesus' response to those who tried to entrap him with this question about whether or not it was lawful for Jews to pay taxes to the Roman emperor. Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. On the Roman coin, which was the legal tender of the empire, and all taxes were to be paid with that coin, it had the image of the Emperor Tiberius stamped onto it. And it even said, Emperor Tiberius, divine son of Augustus, divine son. For the Jews, that meant son of God. You can see how that would be problematic for the Jewish people to have to use coin to pay taxes for the oppressive Roman government that was ruling over them, and to have it be in the name of what the Romans call the Son of God. They knew that there's only one God, and it's not Caesar. In their trap, if the Pharisees could just get Jesus to say that it's okay to pay taxes to the Roman government, it would be unpopular to the common people and to the other Jews. And his standing with the people would take a very big hit. If, on the other hand, Jesus were to say, no, it's not okay to pay taxes to the Roman government, especially when we use coin that refers to someone else as the Son of God, then the Pharisees would have been able to have Jesus arrested for sedition against Rome. It was supposed to be a no-win situation for Jesus. Render unto Caesar what belongs to Caesar. Whose image is on this coin? Then give it to him if he demands it. Render unto God what belongs to God. Giving tithes and offerings to the temple out of glad and grateful hearts is intended by God to help people to flourish and to model people's lives after the one who gives to his people all things. An atmosphere of giving in contrast to an atmosphere of possessing and grasping. This is what we see contrasted here. But somehow Jesus is able to walk right down the middle of this quiz. My question is, what if everything already belongs to God? We people in our time like to think of ourselves as our own gods when it comes to making decisions about temporal things, including and especially money. We can easily feel as though we own everything of our own accord. And so the word possessiveness comes to mind. Strange how we're able to do that when everything we receive in this life is a gift from God. One of the cures we have for that sort of hubris is to give to God at least a portion, just a portion, of what already belongs to Him. I've always called this the sticky fingers syndrome, because giving is the solvent that cuts through the stickiness that sometimes covers possessive human hearts. We Christians believe that everything we have belongs to God. Life, breath, food, water, money, comforts. We are so blessed that God grants these things to us freely. He only asks that we give back a portion to Him. In our case, to support the ministries and the outreach of St. George's, so that we can humbly remember where it all comes from. As a little boy downtown in First Scots Presbyterian Church, I used to watch my dad put his special envelope in the offering plate. Sometimes I would ask him for a quarter to put into the plate. Did you do this with your children? Did you slip them a little bit of money to put in the plate? Did you ask your mom and dad for a little bit of money to put into the plate? Well, I did. I asked him, Dad, why do we give God to God like this? Does He need our money? I was concerned that God's budget was running a little tight. I knew the answer because, as Dad told me many times, quoting Psalm 50, Son, God owns the cattle on a thousand hills. Everything already belongs to Him. God does not need a thing. We give in order to show our thanks for all that He gives to us. All He seeks from you and me, says the psalm, is a grateful heart. Now it's cute when a child asks a parent for money to put in the offering plate. Give it to me so I can give it away. We kind of chuckle and go, the child didn't even earn it. Now he feels like he's giving. How can it mean anything to that child? But isn't that, in a sense, what we do with our giving? We didn't earn it. Now don't fight me on this. I know we went out, we work hard. I know that. But we didn't earn it so much as God gave it to us out of His wide and broad mercy. And now we're giving some of it away. And God is so gracious that He only asks for a portion of it back. He knows we need the money we make and that He gives to us in order to live and to flourish. He wants people to thrive. He also knows we need to give in order to keep our hearts right. Our stewardship theme at St. George's this year is gratitude. I put out several options to the vestry, and they were overwhelmingly, not unanimously, but overwhelmingly in favor of the gratitude theme. Gratitude is the heart of our stewardship. They all agreed. If stewardship is defined as taking care of something that is entrusted to you, at its most basic understanding, it's that what's ours comes from God as a gift. And if all things are gift to us, then there's gratitude. And gratitude generates our giving in return. Not as an obligation, but as recognition of God's love, His care, His provision, His gifts, daily bread, daily grace, daily forgiveness, daily strength, and daily healing. When I moved to Charleston to take a church, our church purchased a rectory. It used to belong to a physician. It was a Jewish family. And I received a piece of mail a couple of months later in my mailbox. I saw that it didn't belong to me, it belonged to them. But right there on the back of the envelope, it said, "Enclosed is your annual assessment to the synagogue." I was taken back. Assessment? Good grief. Well, I knew I had some Jewish friends, and I knew what it was like to belong to some synagogues. They would basically make an assumption of your financial status. And then based on that, they would assess what you go to the synagogue. And furthermore, if they did not follow through with that assessment, when they arrived at synagogue for worship, they had a special set of pews in the back for those who were behind in their assessment. That's a lot more like the taxation thing. That's not one warm fuzzies. Well, so the synagogues have all gotten wiser now, and they've moved away from these assessments, and they've gone to strictly voluntary giving. And they've preached gratitude like we are today. And I read in an article not too long ago from one of these synagogues that a person wrote in and said, "The truth of the matter is, now that they've gone voluntary, I still give the exact same amount as I was assessed before, but I sure feel a lot better about it." We need to give. We want to give. But we are against compulsory giving. It does something to us. It messes up that link between sharing and then having to pay something like a tax. So I want to just end today with 8 signs of grateful giving for us to think about. 8 signs of grateful giving. First, gifts, of course, are given with a heart of gratitude. Second, the giver never speaks of the funds that they give as my money. Number 3, the giver has 0 expectation of personal benefits from the church in exchange for the funds. Number 4, gifts are viewed by the giver as part of his or her walk of discipleship with Jesus. Number 5, the giver seeks no recognition, plaques, or naming privileges for the funds that they give. Number 6, the giver gives with joy. Number 7, if the giver has any regrets about those funds, it's that they really wish that they could give more. Number 8, these funds that they give are first fruits. That is, they take the first amounts taken out of paychecks and other sources of income right off the top, because they know that their God is faithful and will give back to them everything that they need, pressed down, shaken together, pouring into your lap, and overflowing. That's God's economy, and that's the way that He works. Thanks be to God for His almighty grace. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to stand with me and let us say together the words of the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and he was made man. For our sake, he was crucified and unconscious Father. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will come out of no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. You may sit or kneel or remain standing for the prayers of the people.
Let us pray for the church and the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked to ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially Sandra, Lynn, Jenna Rose, Deacon Bill, Seth, Reverend Moore, Elaine, Martha B., Alex, Spencer, Judy, Karen, Joan, Annie, Martha S., Denise, Tim, Kylie, Michelle, Laurie, Allison, Franklin, Tony, Angela, Dan, Jake, and all others we now name before you. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to you your mercy, all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with you, with all your saints, in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father in heaven, we ask your blessings upon our nation as we go through our time of transition in this election season. By your grace, keep our hearts charitable, and by your Holy Spirit, help us to cope well
with the anxiety inherent in these times. Guard us who vote and those who run for office in safety. Let your peace reign in our hearts. As we experience public discourse and engage in democracy for the common good, let our conversation at all times reflect your goodness and respect the dignity of every human being to your honor and glory. Guide and direct and protect all in authority, including Donald, our president, and Henry, our governor, that they may make wise decisions and take right actions for the welfare and peace of all. We ask your provision for those who are in difficult times and pray that they will be encouraged to carry on and to find their rest and relief in you, that their livelihoods and their peace being restored, they may once again flourish and rejoice in your goodness. We ask for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our enemies as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will, walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Let us stand and grant one another the peace of God. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
That's
the end.
You can be seated for just a moment before we turn to the table and receive once again in sacramental form the grace and mercy of our Lord Jesus in the form of his body and blood. I wanted to tell everyone that plans are going forward to have an 11 o'clock service on Sunday, November the 15th outside. So be in prayer that God grants us a beautiful day weather-wise, so that more of us can gather in the safety of what is outdoors. We will still wear masks and take all kinds of social distancing measures, but we do need to see one another. We do need to have fellowship. We do need to be able to catch up. And so that's the intent of that day. Stewardship letters went out to everyone. It's kind of like, you know, when I don't get my tax form from the IRS, I call them up and I say, hey, I didn't get my tax form this year. So if you didn't get a pledge card this year, say, hey, I want one because I want to make a pledge to St. George's. People really do that sometimes, you know. So anyway, blessings upon you all. It's so good to see you here once again. Jerry, would you mind painting the room a little bit just so that people can, at home, can have a sense of those of us gathered here? And I invite you to sign up to go online at stgeorge-sc.org and simply say, I want to attend thus and so service if you find the next service that's available. If we're not going too much over capacity, I've asked Diane to open it up a little bit so that more people can come. Still maintaining social distance, safe social distancing, and yet we're slowly but surely trying to open up. We're also keeping a wary eye on the COVID numbers to make sure that things aren't starting to get out of hand. But we're prayerful that God is going to allow us to begin to experience our togetherness in better ways as time goes on. We will see how it works out. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. become of thee, O Lord.
And thou, have we given thee.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death. You, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he gave it thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father,
Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us be pleased.
Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of our Lord Jesus.
heart. You have graciously accepted us as the members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Let us now stand for our processional hymn, which is hymn number 594, God of Grace and God of Glory.